Well, church, again, we continue this morning, again, in the book of Jonah. And I want to ask, whoever here has used Cliff's Notes? Anyone? Does anyone? Hand, show of hands. Just like, no one's ever heard of Cliff's Notes. Okay, there's a couple of people looking very guilty. No. All right, so Cliff's Notes, they're short student study guide booklets that they provide like a summary or an explanation on various books, literary works, stuff like that, right? So they're great resources, but the ongoing joke or the criticism is, right, that a student can read Cliff's Notes on a subject and successfully be able to avoid a proper reading of the actual text, right? Charles Dickens, Great Expectations. Why read that when you could read Cliff's Notes? And it'll give you all you need to write your assignments and do your studies, right? And I certainly made good use of Cliff's Notes in my education, as you can probably sadly tell. You may be able to pass an assignment with Cliff's Notes, with an abbreviated study guide, but if that is the level that you choose to engage the topic at, right, you will miss out on the full knowledge of the text and all of the richness associated with whatever that text is. And I think a great danger with the study of the Word of God is that we would settle for like the Cliff's Notes on Scripture. And I was thinking about this, what would the Cliff's Notes be on Jonah? Probably just go like this: Jonah hears God, Jonah disobeys God, Jonah runs, Jonah swallowed by a great fish, Jonah vomited by said fish, Jonah cries out against Nineveh, Nineveh repents, Jonah's mad. Right? You probably get away with that. Right, someone says, tell me the story of Jonah, and you know, if you gave those points, you'd probably get the gist of it. But I want to encourage us, church, this morning, that we would refuse to settle for anything less than the full counsel of Scripture. Every teaching, every principle, every truth, everything contained within that book reveals God's heart and His nature to us. Let's embrace it, I think, in its entirety, never neglecting these lesser-known parts or the parts that it's so easy to gloss over, right? Like they're somehow less important. And so last week's sermon was on, you know, what to do when we find ourselves in the belly of the fish. And we found our conclusion in the last verse of Jonah chapter 2, which is this: "And the Lord spoke to the fish, and it vomited Jonah out upon the dry land." So after you turn with me, obviously, to Jonah, we're going to read chapter 3 this morning, and we're going to read that in its entirety. Hopefully, if you've got a physical Bible, you've got it bookmarked by now. And if you don't, hopefully you're getting very quick with turning to the book of Jonah. Okay, let me read this to us, starting at verse 1. "Then the word of the Lord came to Jonah the second time, saying, 'Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and call out against it the message that I tell you.' So Jonah arose and went to Nineveh according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly great city, 3 days' journey in breadth. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's journey, and he called out, 'Yet 40 days, and Nineveh shall be overthrown.' And the people of Nineveh believed God. They called for a fast and put on sackcloth, from the greatest of them to the least. The word reached the king of Nineveh, and he arose from his throne, removed his robe, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat in ashes. And he issued a proclamation and published through Nineveh: 'By the decree of the king and his nobles, let neither man nor beast, herd nor flock, taste anything. Let them not feed or drink water, but let man and beast be covered with sackcloth, and let them call out mightily to God. Let everyone turn from his evil way, and from the violence that is in his hands. Who knows, God may turn and relent and turn from his fierce anger so that we may not perish.'" Verse 10, "When God saw they did, how they turned from their evil way, God relented of the disaster that he had said he would do to them. And he did not do it." I've entitled today's sermon, "A Heart Not After God's." Please let me pray for us quickly this morning. Father, come, speak to us, change us this morning. Change our hearts into ones after your own. And that is what we desire as we pour ourselves into your word this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so like I said, we picked up from verse 10. Jonah's just been vomited out upon the dry land. And it says the word of the Lord came to Jonah. So it comes to him a second time, right? Once should have been enough for Jonah, but God is so gracious with him. And the message is repeated. And I think this is a beautiful picture of our God, that even when we would actively resist his call, when we would actively rebel against him, if we are faithful to turn back and repent, he will call again. He doesn't write us off, though we may fail him 100 times, 1,000 times, even more. Instead, he still extends towards us his grace and his mercy. And I've said it the last few weeks. If you find yourself here this morning, it means he is still preserving you. And now is a good opportunity to turn back to him. And I think about how God described himself to Moses in Exodus 34:6. Now there's a lot of scripture where others are describing God, inspired obviously by the Holy Spirit to write those words. But we have fewer examples where God himself describes himself. And so Exodus 34:6, the Lord says of himself, the Lord, a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. And I think this is so amazing, right? So for those of us who have found ourselves vomited upon the dry land, that you can sympathize with Jonah, right? Remember that that is the God that we serve. Gracious, merciful, abounding in steadfast love. So Jonah rises and it says he goes to Nineveh, and we're told of the enormity of this city, that it would take 3 days to walk across the city. So he travels for about a day and then he calls this out. He says, yet 40 days and Nineveh shall be overthrown. Now what did he mean when he said, you know, Nineveh will be overthrown? To us, you know, it could conjure up different ideas, but to the people of the time, they knew exactly what it meant. And the Hebrew word here speaks of an overturning, but it carries a meaning of destruction. He's saying, hey, in 40 days, Nineveh is going to be destroyed. In fact, it's actually the same word that we see in Genesis 19 and Lamentations 4, where Sodom and Gomorrah are referred to, and their destruction is referred to. So Jonah uses 8 words, or at least 8 words in English, to tell people in Nineveh, hey, this place is going to be destroyed in 40 days. What's interesting is, as we said, Jonah was the most likely author of this book. It was him. And it's interesting that, you know, the text, or the author, doesn't implicitly indicate that any more than that was said. It said, Jonah cried this out, and those are the 8 words that we have in English. Just what we read in Jonah 3, chapter 2. God tells Jonah to cry out against Nineveh with the message that he will provide him. So maybe, I was thinking about this, maybe that is all God wanted Jonah to say. Maybe it was that simple. Jonah, go and cry out with the message that I've given to you. Right? But it's interesting because the message recorded here is so basic. And when you look at all of the rest of the Old Testament, the Old Testament prophets, when they would cry out to the nation of Israel or to other nations, they were long, they were elaborate. Similar messages warning about, you know, impending destruction if they were not turned to God. But it was a lot more elaborate. Why only such a basic, almost phrase, a short sentence from Jonah? Unlike the extensive warnings and rebukes we see elsewhere. And so I was pondering this. And I thought maybe he used so few words because that is the exact message that God gave him to share. I think that's what he shared. Or maybe he used so few words because his heart for them was that they would be overthrown. It was that they would be destroyed. And so, in Jonah's mind, that was that. In 40 days, you're getting destroyed. And I'm going to tell the rest of the city. And I think this could very well have been the case. And the reason I think this is because when we look at the rest of the story, we get an idea about Jonah's heart. Jonah cries out against the people, God shows mercy, and this is what we read in Jonah 4, 1-3. So God has just shown mercy on the people of Nineveh. He's relented from the destruction. And it says, but it displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he was angry. And he prayed to the Lord and said, O Lord, is not this what I said when I was yet in my country? That is why I made haste to flee Tarshish. For I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and relenting from disaster. Therefore now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. Can we just turn the gain down a little bit on this? Or Bill, do you mind just swiveling the speakers a fraction?
It's ringing.
It's okay. It's ringing. It's not the angels. It's the mic. I guess the question is, what caused Jonah to disobey at the start of the story, church? Right? We know he disobeyed. We know he ran. But I don't think it was because he failed to comprehend God's heart for the people of Nineveh. In fact, he actually shows us that he had an accurate understanding of God's nature from what he says in Jonah 4:2. He's like, I told you this is what you were going to do. Right? And what is really interesting is, in Jonah 4:2 that we just read through, as he's saying, you know, this is what you are like, he's actually almost exactly quoting Exodus 34:6. So he knew the character and the nature of God. Right? There was no question. It wasn't, you know, that was never any doubt there. And we paraphrase it, you know, Jonah's mad. He says, I told you, you're going to do this. And this is why I ran, because I knew you were going to forgive them. He actually then goes on, just kill me now. Take my life, Lord. I think in this, Jonah demonstrates all along what was within his heart. There was a dislike, or we could say a hate, for the Ninevites. There was a desire for their destruction. And then there was an anger when mercy was extended towards them. Church, I think at the root of Jonah's disobedience was this. Not that he didn't know, or that he didn't comprehend God's heart for the people of Nineveh. He knew that all along. I think that he disobeyed, he ran, he hated, all because he did not have a heart that loved the same things that God loved and hated the same things that God hated. He did not have a heart that was after God's own. And that was ultimately, you know, questionable in the start, but revealed in Jonah 4. When God relents, God shows mercy, and everything within Jonah comes to the surface. He wanted them to get it. He wanted their destruction. He was like, I knew you were going to do this. And it wasn't just, Lord, that's a bit annoying because I made the trick. If you were going to save them, you could have just used someone from Nineveh to do this. It wasn't that. That wasn't his level of anger. He goes, take my life. Take my life. He did not have a heart that was like God's. Jonah had knowledge of God, he had knowledge of his ways, but his knowledge had not migrated from his head to his heart. And if he would have had a heart of after God's own, the gracious, the merciful, the slow to anger heart within Jonah, the same as God, would have gotten up when he first heard the word. He would have gone to Nineveh the first time, and, you know, not only would he have not disobeyed in dramatic fashion, but in Nineveh, he would have cried out and pleaded with these people, please, turn, repent. Turn now while you can. Turn back to God. Knowing that God could very well, you know, the gracious and merciful God, forgive those with broken and contrite hearts. Jonah knew this. It says he knew this. It says he actually said this to God before he left. I don't know about you. When I think about the story of Jonah, it ends very abruptly. And we're going to look at that, you know, moving into next week or two. But you know the story, you know, he's angry with God, and it just kind of ends like that. And I always find myself kind of appalled by Jonah's behavior, right? Each time I read this story, I'm like, man, he's just I don't even know if you can just call him grumpy. I think it's beyond grumpy. It's almost wickedness in that heart, that he wanted to see these people just get it. He wanted to see them destroyed. And when they turned and repented, it wasn't good enough. It was good enough for God, it wasn't good enough for Jonah. But when I read that story, I realize that the behavior from Jonah is a symptom of a heart issue, right? And then I have to reflect in humility on my own heart and realize that as is with most men and women of Scripture, I share that same heart, right? I'm human just like these men and women. I'm human just like Jonah, prone to the same things, the same thoughts, the same feelings. And it's so easy to separate and go, well, that was just Jonah. Jonah was just a bad guy. But are we often in life too dissimilar to Jonah? I want to ask us, do we have a heart like God's this morning? Do we love the things he loves? Do we pursue the things that he values? Do we hate the things that he hates? Having a heart after God's own means having a sincere and deep desire to align our thoughts, our affections, our actions with God's heart, His will and His purposes. And Spurgeon said this, and I love this, he said, "Oh, to have the heart so united with the Lord that it beats only to the great purposes of God and longs only for the glory of Jesus." And I would ask that this morning of us. Is our heart united with the Lord in shared nature and shared affection? I want me to offer you this morning, I'm going to offer you, according to God's word, just a couple of the many reasons as to why we so often do not have the same heart as God, the same affections, the same love for the things of God as we should. And so we'll look at some of those reasons. There's a myriad, but then I want to point us towards the remedy. So first I would say to us, we don't love what God loves because, and going right back to the start, because of original sin. I'm not talking about, just in case there's any confusion, and I will explain briefly, right? I'm not talking about original sin. Don't think of like, is that like unique ways to sin that like no one else has done before? Because some of you are probably good at that kind of original sin. Kids are. No, that's not what they're talking about. You know, we're referring to the doctrine of original sin. And as descendants of Adam and Eve, descendants of Adam, we have this imputed condemnation, a consequence of Adam's sin against God. And we inherit this simple nature that inclines us, our hearts, towards sin, self-centeredness, and rebellion against God. And we're born into this state where our hearts are at natural enmity with Him. Romans 5:12, Paul tells us this. He says, "Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men because all sinned." We enter this world sinners, right? You know, I don't believe this, that, you know, people are inherently good, right? And I hear people say that all the time. And if you look at the world, if you look at society, and you examine your own heart and your own thoughts on a daily basis, you will not agree with this. And if you do agree with this, I would ask you what standard of morality you are holding up. The reality is we enter this world as sinners, and there is no hope for us outside of the good news of Jesus. But there is hope. Because we are born into a sin, a consequence of this is that our affections are misdirected. Our natural inclination is, you know, the reverse of Colossians 3, chapter 2. Rather than setting our minds, our eyes, our hearts on things that are above and not things that are below, we set our eyes on things that are temporal. We set our hearts on things that are fleeting, and we prioritize these over, you know, the eternal and God's glory. There's no natural inclination towards righteousness. There's only an inclination towards self. The good news, like I said, however, is that through the regenerating work of the Holy Spirit, our hearts are transformed and our love for God and His ways is kindled. Titus 3:5, it says, "He saved us not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to His own mercy, by the washing of regeneration and the renewal of the Holy Spirit." What do we mean by regeneration? It's the supernatural work of the Holy Spirit that gives life to those dead in their trespasses, allowing them to then repent and believe the gospel. It's a beautiful thing. We talk about it. You've heard it mentioned here. You've heard John. I know John loves to talk about it. Through the Spirit, we enjoy this ongoing process after we are regenerated of sanctification in our lives, continually reorientating our affections and aligning them with God's heart. This is a process. This is not something that happens immediately overnight. And wouldn't that be great if at the point of regeneration and repentance and turning and placing our saving faith in Jesus, that all of a sudden all of our affections for the world and the temporal and the money and the job and the careers and the house and everything else that would take up our time in this life that is a vapor, wouldn't it be amazing if they all just disappeared? But the reality is, that is not the case. He's saying, "Sam, it's rough. We were born into sin. I was born this way." And that's okay. That's why we must be born again. This is an evidence of salvation, church. Right? This is an evidence of salvation, that we would slowly but surely have a change of our heart's affections. A heart that each day, bit by bit, looks more and more like God's. If you tell me you've been a Christian for 20 years, yet none of your affections are towards Him, well, we would question the statement objectively according to Scripture. So we don't love what God loves because, going back to the fall, original sin. We don't love because we don't love what God loves because we fail to recognize His immense worth. Has anyone watched that TV show Antiques Roadshow? Right, some of you know it better than Cliff's Notes. Right, I actually love that. I actually love that show because, and this is the wickedness in me. I love that show for two reasons. And the first reason, which is not great, is I love it when someone comes and like, this is a great antique. You know, it's passed down from all these generations, and then, you know, the evaluator looks at it and goes, actually, that was like mass-produced, and, you know, it's worth like $2. And there's something wicked within me that, like, I laugh at that. You know, as devastating as that is to probably those people. But I also really like seeing the opposite, where people come and they go, I've got this, it's been in the family forever, I don't know, and they say, oh, what were you hoping to get from it? Oh, you know, maybe like £500. And they say, well, actually, this is worth, you know, to the right person, maybe 90,000, and you watch their face and they realize that they have something there of immeasurable worth, and they didn't realize it before, but as they grasp that, you watch their countenance change, their face change, knowing that it's going to change their life, right, for many of these people. And I would ask us this morning, church, do we know the value of what we have grasped a hold of? Have we rightly recognized the surpassing worth and beauty of God? Matthew 13, 44 to 46. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in the field, which a man found and covered up. Then in his joy he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls, who on finding one pearl of great value, went and sold all that he had and bought it. Have we grasped the immeasurable worth, the immeasurable value of the treasure and the pearl? Or have we settled for lesser joys and pursuits that can never really satisfy the human heart as God can, because we don't know the value of God and His kingdom? Church, when we behold the glory and the goodness of God, we will, like the man who finds the treasure, or like the merchant looking for the pearl of great price, we will be overcome by the worth of knowing Him and being known by Him. And it will change our lives. When we see God as our greatest joy, our love for Him will naturally grow. And as our love for Him grows, our affections start to align with His. Our desires start to align with His. Our heart begins to look more and more like His when you realize the value of what we have. Who is described as a man after God's own heart in Scripture? It's not a rhetorical question. Call it out if you know.
David,
right? David, 1 Samuel 13, 14, also mentioned in Acts. And David actually writes in Psalm 27, verse 4, this: one thing have I asked of the Lord that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in His temple. One thing I've asked of the Lord. David was a man. He was many things. You read about his life. Right, he was no perfect man, but he was a man who had grasped the immeasurable worth of the God whom he served. And because he knew the worth of the one that he served, everything else in his life flowed from this. And this is why he was a man after God's own heart. One thing I desire, one thing I seek. He could have asked for anything. He could have desired anything. You know, and put a Christian little spin on it, but instead it was to be known by God and to know God, to worship Him in His beauty and His majesty, because David recognized what he had in God. If we don't know what we have, if we don't have an appreciation for that, if we don't have an appreciation for the good news of Jesus, then it makes sense we would not have our heart affections aligned with God's. We don't love what God loves because, John talked a little bit about this morning, this doesn't appeal to our flesh. Alright, so if we talk about the flesh, you know, it's 20 sermons in itself, but let me just briefly explain what I mean by the flesh. We know that the term flesh refers to the fallen, sinful nature that resides within each one of us. And it's that part of our being that is inclined towards rebellion against God. It's inclined towards selfish desires and sinful behaviours. And you hear the Apostle Paul speak of this often throughout his epistles, particularly in the book of Romans. Romans 7, 18 to 19, he says, "For I know that nothing good dwells in me, that is, in my flesh. For I have the desire to do what is right, but not the ability to carry it out. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I keep doing." sobering, partly encouraging for us, because, you know, we wrestle and war against the flesh and say, hey, you know, it's not just us. Even the greats, even the Apostle Paul, warred against the flesh. You see, the flesh is in constant opposition to the Spirit of God that dwells within us when we are saved. Galatians 5:17 tells us, for the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh, for these are opposed to each other, to keep you from doing the things you want to do. And we remember that regeneration, whilst the profound and transformative work of the Holy Spirit, is not the complete eradication of the fallen nature. Rather, regeneration is the beginning of a process of spiritual transformation and renewal. As long as we are on this earth, the flesh will seek to incline us towards disobedience and self-centeredness. Don't believe me? Let's examine our lives, even just this week. How many decisions were made in the flesh, you know, to benefit self, self-centered decisions? I say that not to shame us. I said it to myself as well, but that is the reality, that we are constantly at war with the flesh. Now think about Jonah. Jonah's flesh led him to disobey God and run from his word, and also had him hope for the destruction of others. Also caused him to be angry when God was merciful. Because in the flesh, Jonah just wanted to see those people get it. He didn't want to get up and travel. Well, what, 500 miles if he'd gone initially in the right direction? He didn't want to have to go and do that journey on camel, on foot, I don't know. You know, to preach to a wicked people who had at times and would in the future oppress the people of Israel. He didn't want to do that. That didn't appeal to his flesh. Of course it wouldn't. When the flesh is allowed to run rampant, we will never learn to love God the way that we should. And our focus will always be on us. Our desires, our agenda, our comfort, our gratification. Your flesh does not want you to have a heart like God's. Nothing about going to Nineveh appealed to Jonah's flesh. But I would say this to him, I would say this to us. Since when has the benchmark for obedience been reduced to whether something is easy, whether something is comfortable, whether something is appealing, or whether something provides instant gratification? That is not our benchmark, is it, church? We will never have a proper love for what God does if we continually seek to gratify our flesh. May we rightfully recognize our need for spiritual growth, for sanctification, and for continued reliance on God's grace to overcome the sinful tendencies of the flesh. We'll talk a little bit more about that in a second. But next, we don't love what God loves because the cost is too great. There's a great song. I think other people have sung it. The original artist is a guy called Michael Stampley, and the song is called Take My Life. And it's a song that goes, holiness, holiness is what I love. That you've probably heard. Actually, I don't know if he's the original there, but he sings at least this chorus. He definitely wrote this. And it says, so take my heart and mold it. Take my mind, transform it. Take my will, conform it. To yours, O Lord. And the song is simple and it's beautiful, right? Lord, take my heart, mold it, make it like yours, Lord. And we sing it and it sounds great in theory. When we think about it, God's heart is for the lost. It's for the broken, for the sick, for the poor, for the sinner. Will you love these people like God loves them? God's heart is that disciples will be made of all nations, men and women, boys and girls, being reached with the gospel. In difficult places, in hostile places, in places where there is significant persecution, will you make the sacrifices that are needed to see his will accomplished? John Piper says this, he says, having a heart like God's is costly. It will cost you your comfort, your convenience, and your self-centeredness. For many, to give up these things is too great. We would rather settle for a watered-down version of Christianity that merely skims the surface of genuine devotion. One that allows us to keep the cost low. We'd rather do that than follow a true biblical Christianity where we have to wholeheartedly surrender our lives, take up our crosses, and follow Christ without reservation. That is a tough Christianity. That is a costly Christianity, but that is a biblical Christianity. Having a heart that loves God, it will cost us. But church, it is worth the cost. Because having a heart like God's is the path to true joy, to lasting fulfillment, and to eternal treasure. We looked at, you know, this kind of stuff in the book of James. I don't know what the Holy Spirit might be bringing conviction to you about this morning. But I can say this with certainty. We all, in some way, have a heart like Jonah's. We all need a heart that is more like God's. And thirdly, we do not wake up out of the blue with a heart like God's. It's not just a snap of the fingers. And like I said, it would be great if God would do that for us. And there's many reasons why he doesn't. But you're not just going to wake up with a heart after God's own. You don't just wake up one day and find yourself having gone from a Jonah to a David. Would ask us, are we willing to do what's necessary to have a heart like God's? He's made a way for us to be regenerated. He has shown us his matchless worth. He's revealed to us the futility of a life that is lived in the flesh. And he's called us to count the cost. So if we are serious about having a heart that is so united with the Lord that it beats only to the great purposes of God and longs only for the glory of Jesus, like Spurgeon said, a heart that loves what he loves, then let us take steps towards this morning, church. There's 100 things that we could do. Let me just give us a few quickly. Firstly, develop a heart after God by putting your flesh to death. Romans 8:13. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. And I stumbled across this a while ago, and I wanted to share this with you. This is not my analogy. It was an analogy from John Piper. He used it 30 years ago. And it's, either the analogy is perfect, scripture is perfect, but hopefully this conveys the message that I'm trying to share with you today. So John Piper says this, he says, picture your flesh, that old ego with the mentality of merit and craving for power and reputation and self-reliance. Picture it as a dragon living in some cave of your soul. Then you hear the gospel, and in it Jesus Christ comes to you and says, I will make you mine and take possession of the cave and slay the dragon. Will you yield to my possession? It will mean a whole new way of thinking and feeling and acting. You say, but that dragon is me, I will die. He says, and you will rise to newness of life, for I will take its plan. I will make my mind and my will and my heart your own. And you say, what must I do? He answers, trust me and do as I say. As long as you trust me, we cannot lose. Overcome by the beauty and the power of Christ, you bow and you swear eternal loyalty and trust. And as you rise, he puts a great sword in your hand and he says, follow me. He leads you to the mouth of the cave and says, go in, slay the dragon. But you look at him bewildered. I cannot, not without you. He smiles. Well said, you learn quickly. Never forget my commands for you to do something are never commands to do it alone. Then you enter the cave together. A horrid battle follows and you feel Christ's hand on yours. At last, the dragon lies limp. You ask, is it dead? His answer is this, I have come to give you new life. This you received when you yielded to my possession and swore faith and loyalty to me. And now with my sword in my hand, you have felled the dragon of the flesh. It is a mortal wound. It will die, that is certain, but it has not yet bled to death, and it may yet revive with violent convulsions and do much harm. So you must treat it as dead and seal the cave as a tomb. The Lord of Darkness may cause earthquakes in your soul to shake the stones loose, but you build them up again and have this confidence. With my sword and my hand on yours, the dragon's doom is sure. He is finished and your new life is secured. And I love that picture. I love that picture. Luke 9:23, and he said to all, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. Church, we will never be able to deny ourselves, take up our cross and serve our King if we don't first make sure that the dragon is incapacitated, struck down, sealed away. Because if this is not done, the dragon will run rampant and seek to have his way in every situation, every single time. And I think that has been the reality for some of us in different seasons of our life when we've been given over to the flesh. When everything we do is a decision made in the flesh. When we are living in the flesh, when that dragon is left unaddressed. Want to have a heart like God's? I do. Let us put the flesh to death. Each day, surrender your own will and desires to God's sovereign authority. Ask the Holy Spirit to continually work in your heart, transforming your desires to mirror his own church. Secondly, develop a heart after God's buy. Sounds pretty simple. Knowing his heart. Right? Seems simple. But this is the truth. Surely we cannot hope to have a heart after God's own if we have no idea what he loves and what he hates. Husbands, question for you. Did you spend the first few years of your relationship, say the first few years of your marriage, buying your wife random gifts like golf clubs or tools or car parts? Anyone do that? Can you imagine, Robbie? Jane? Happy birthday. I've got you a socket set. It's great. Throw it back at him. Of course. Of course you did. Hopefully no one's done this, right? But you don't. You spend time, and you get to know that person. And you know the things that they love. You know that the things that they don't, things that they dislike. And you act accordingly. Church, we need to pour ourselves into God's word. It's simple, yet it's effective. We should diligently study his word. We should memorize it. We should read books on the character of God. We should get a solid grasp and a clear understanding of the gospel. If we learn his word, if we get to know his word, if we're intimately acquainted with his word, we'll know the things that he loves. As I said earlier, you don't just wake up and say, hey, it was great. God's at me. Now I know everything about his heart and I can just let that dictate my actions. But no, instead, each day, as we seek him with all that we have, his Holy Spirit reveals to us more and more of his heart, his character, his nature. In the same way you build muscle or stamina at a gym, spiritually discipline yourself to grasp a hold of God's word in the same way. Right? Build up to it. If you are not in the habit of opening your Bible, don't necessarily sit down this afternoon and go, all right, 3 hours of Bible reading, and I'm going to do that every day for the rest of my life. You know, build up to it. Jody's a great runner. I mean, we've got a few great runners here. Where's... She's not here. Did you say Crystal? Looking for Crystal. Oh! You've been too quiet in the front, Christine. No, we've got some great runners, right? But you don't just turn up and go out one day and go, oh, we're going to run a marathon. The average person doesn't do that. Right? You build up to it. If we want to have his heart, we must know his heart. And the only way we get his heart is through immersing ourselves in God's word. And this is the foundation for aligning our desires with God's. Regular reading, meditating on his word, and obeying it is essential for understanding his character, his will, and his desires. And as we saturate our minds with scripture, the Holy Spirit transforms our thinking and our desires to align with God's truth. When we seek to know his heart, we will inevitably begin to know his heart. We'll grasp the enormity of God's love and the beauty of his character and have our hearts naturally drawn to love and to adore him more fully. Thirdly, develop a heart after God by surrounding yourself with David's. Right? Church, surround yourself with fellow believers who are committed to living in accordance with God's desires. Surround yourself with people who are seeking the Spirit's sanctification. Surround yourself with people who, although flawed, cry out with every fiber of their being, Father, I want to have a heart like your own. Surround yourself with these people, right? Not perfect people, but people who are journeying towards God, are journeying towards his heart. Actively seeking both discipleship and accountability will provide valuable support and encouragement in the journey of aligning your heart to God's. Last night when I spoke about the church, we mentioned this thing about lone rangerism, right? We must remember that fellow believers play a vital role in helping us cultivate a heart that is increasingly aligned with God's own heart. Proverbs 27:17 reminds us about how iron sharpens iron, so one person sharpens another. This is why we're in family. This is why we are connected. I have a responsibility to you to spur you on so that you would have a heart that is more like God's each day. And you have that responsibility to me. If you are joined to this family, we share in that responsibility. When we engage with meaningful fellowship and relationship, we have the opportunity to encourage one another in the pursuit of godliness. And we are familiar with this scripture, Colossians 3:16. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom. You know, this mutual teaching and admonition occurs when we come together, sharing God's word together and holding each other accountable in love. Ask yourself this morning, who have you surrounded yourself with? Jonas or David's? The body of believers serves as a source of encouragement, edification and sharpening. And this ultimately aids us in our pursuit of having a heart that mirrors the character of our glorious God. And finally, develop a heart after God's by, and maybe this could have gone first because I think this is the most key, relying on the Holy Spirit for transformation. Church, there is no conflict between God's sovereign work and man's responsibility in any area, right? I don't seek to reconcile friends, to borrow from Spurgeon. But in the pursuit of transforming our hearts into a reflection of God's own heart, we have to recognize our absolute dependence on the Holy Spirit. This divine transformation isn't just some sort of self-improvement project, right? It's a supernatural work of the Spirit within us. As Paul emphatically declares in 2 Corinthians 3:18, he says this, "And we all, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord who is the Spirit." I want you to notice this key phrase, from one degree of glory to another. This transformative act, work, it's progressive, it's lifelong, and it is solely a work of the Lord through the Holy Spirit. It begins with our continual beholding of the glory of the Lord, which means fixing our gaze on Christ, devoting ourselves to His Word and seeking His presence in prayer. As we do these things, the Holy Spirit gradually conforms us into the likeness of Christ, transforming our heart into one that is after God's own. Church, our good Father has given us the Holy Spirit, the Helper, who intercedes on our behalf and empowers us to pursue a heart after God's own heart. Because if it is just a work in the flesh, if it's just a carnal work, we will never get there. Our transformation into the image of God's heart is a cooperative work. We cooperate with the Holy Spirit by surrendering, seeking, and walking in step with Him. And it is through His sanctifying presence and power that our hearts are gradually conformed to the heart of our Heavenly Father. The question ultimately is, will we submit to Him? Will we submit to His work? Will we allow Him to change our hearts? Church, you will continue to face many Ninevehs in your life. And by that I mean the word of the Lord will continue to come to you and your flesh is not going to want a bar of it. I'm not just saying, you know, the word of the Lord is going to come to you and it's, you know, Bill, go off to Africa. I'm not talking about that kind of level. It's day to day. The word of the Lord comes to us. We have the word of the Lord in His scripture. And we read that and our flesh does not want a bar of it, right? And we can get up and run. We can get up and disobey. We can get up and try and flee from the presence of God. We can get up and do what He's told us with wrong motives, with a wrong heart attitude, right? Or we can draw a line in the sand today and say, Lord, no matter what the cost, I want a heart like yours. I want a heart after yours. Lord, let me put my flesh to death. Lord, let me submit to the work of your Holy Spirit. Transform me, Lord. I don't like those Ninevites. I don't want to go to Nineveh. It's inconvenient. Every part of my being says no, but Lord, I want a heart like yours. Transform me as I go. Transform me as I love you. Transform me as I pour myself into your word. Teach me to have a heart like your own. Please stand with me this morning. Father, I think we would much rather see ourselves as David rather than as Jonah, as someone with a heart after your own. But so often, Lord, the reality is we are more like Jonah in our behaviors, in our words, in our pursuits, in our heart attitudes, Father God. But Lord, we don't want to stay there. We want a heart after your own. Yes.
Yes.
Father, let us be committed. This cooperative work made possible by the empowerment and transforming power of the Holy Spirit. Change our hearts into ones that look like yours.
Yes.
That love others. That love the kingdom. That love the gospel. That would go. That would serve. That would count the cost daily. Do what only you can do, Father God. Let us pour ourselves into your word. That is the remedy. That is the remedy for every bit of flesh that seeks to rebel and seeks to come out of the cave, Father God. It's the remedy for not knowing your character and your nature. Let us pour into it, Father God, and as we do, transform us. Take our hearts, take our lives, and mold it and transform it so that we look like you, so that we have a heart after yours.
Yes.
In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. God bless you, church.